gonna go to take the teacher for the day. And we're gonna get into continuation of this series, the end time series. Today we're addressing the shadow of things to come. We're dealing with the end times and we in perilous times now. But there are certain things the Lord can show that the Lord has in his word as we dealt with the signs of the last days. But this week, we're gonna show you how the feast of the Lord deals with the end times. Because I always teach that the Lord has a past, present, and future meaning in his feast. So we're not going to tap the and dive into all the past or the present. What we're going to show you, because we're dealing with the end times, how the Passover pointed to the last days, how the unleavened bread in the end times, the Pentecost, the trumpet, the affliction, the Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles, and right in the seventh day, the Lord showed you the judgment. We're going to be judged.
Amen.
So, without further ado, let's go to Matthew 24, chapter and verse 3. Because we've knocked the rapture out the box.
Amen.
And we've dealt with what the mark of the beast is right now in our current time and date, today. You know, they just got to doing that thing this past Wednesday, right, y'all?
Sure.
You know, we're saying people, what they call Ash Wednesday, putting his mark in the forehead. You know what I'm saying? People not realizing, but see, you know, a lot of people get off into the holidays and all of that, had no idea that that has nothing to do with salvation nor the Lord.
Amen.
But the feast of the Lord got everything to do with your salvation, even including the last days.
Amen.
That's what we're going to deal with in this. So my brother, we can read at Matthew 24 and Matthew 24 chapter and verse 3.
Matthew 24 and 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came on him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?"
Now look, they asked him a couple of things here. What shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And a lot of people don't realize that the feast of the Lord point towards what happened at the end of this world, as we know. Go ahead.
And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you."
That's the first thing we got to pay attention in these end times, y'all. That no man deceive you. Go ahead.
"For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many."
Now look, this is so bad nowadays. You know, you ask the average Christian about the Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Pentecost. They got the Pentecost all screwed up. So they're deceived about that, the trumpets, the Day of Affliction, the Tabernacles. All these things belong to the Lord, but you find them caught up in the holidays. Why? Because of what we just got to read. Many are going to be deceived in this name. And I've been taught about the Lord's feast. But we're going to show you in this lesson, in this series, how the feast point towards the end time and is very relevant to salvation. So let's get down to verse 11. Because I went through several pieces of this in the series, but we're going to deal with what's pertinent for us right now. In this lesson, part of the series. Verse 11.
"And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many."
Mm-hmm.
"And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold."
We dealt with that in the times of the last days, and y'all know iniquity is abounding. Big time. Big time. That's one of the signs. Go ahead.
"But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved."
Uh-huh.
"And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come."
But notice what Jesus just said here. And this gospel, what gospel is he talking about? Because he qualifies. This gospel that you need to be, take heed that no man deceive you. This gospel that says many false prophets going to rise and shall deceive many. And that the love of many going to wax cold and iniquity going to abound. You ain't going to hear that in the churches all day tomorrow. They're in there, it's a hallelujah dance and a shout. Okay, you're going to hear this gospel of the kingdom that's being preached to all the world for a witness, and then shall the end come. Now, this thing, when the Lord said this, how far you think the message went at that time? Didn't go that far, only those that were woke, right? But look at us now. We're on the internet. This could be heard in Africa right now, Russia, China, across the globe. So we're preaching the gospel that's warning the people globally, fulfilling this entire prophecy right here, right now.
Yeah. Amen.
The ministry that put forth this type of doctrine, y'all. But go ahead.
And the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for witness of all nations, then shall the end come. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place, whoso read it, let him understand.
So that means all the way down to the end time, the prophets are still good. Oh, why is what Jesus said, whoso read it, let him understand, and this abomination that make the desolate spoken of by Daniel the prophet, that's in the old covenant, under the old covenant when that was given. So those prophecies are still yet to be fulfilled. So now, continue.
Let him which is on the housetop come not down and take anything out of his house. Mm-hmm. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes.
Now this is how urgent this is. I think you skipped verse 16.
Did I?
Yes, it was.
Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains.
Now look, we dealt with that when we dealt with the rapture versus the time to flee. It was a knockout.
Yes, sir.
It was over. Rapture never got back off the floor.
Nope.
The time to flee has been established at the chance. So, like Jesus said, there's a time to flee when you see this abomination and make it destiny standing on place. We dealt with that in prior lessons as a part of this series. But we're going for something else. Go ahead.
Let him which on the housetop come not down to take anything out of his house, neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes.
Mm-hmm. That's how urgent things are going to be, real urgent. Go ahead.
And woe to them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days.
So it's going to be hard to move with little babies. You know, little two-year-olds, the little babies that just got born. Now, okay? Babies like that. Little suckling child, that's when they're similar, that's when they're breastfeeding. It's going to be hard to move because they're going to be crying. Yes. And you know how when it is when newborns come out, little babies come out, your whole sleeping cycle, you double. I mean, you could be up all night. But imagine trying to move with a baby, and you're supposed to be quiet when you try to run. People seeking out. So that's why he said, woe to them that are with child, and to them that get suck in those days. That don't mean they ain't going to make it, but it's going to be rough going. But go ahead.
But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day.
See, all the way down to this time period, when this is really in full bloom, notice how Jesus said, pray that your flight be not in the winter, nor on the Sabbath day. That's how important the Sabbath day never changed. And we're going to deal with how the Sabbath day points toward the end times. Okay? Now watch this though. Go ahead. We'll get back to that a little bit. Go ahead.
For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be.
Now look, let's get down to verse 29, because we're going for something, because Jesus went to some things, but for the intents and purposes of showing you how the feast go. Watch this. Go ahead. Verse 29.
Immediately after the tribulation of those days, shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light. Uh-huh. And the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken.
Yes, sir.
And then shall the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory.
Now notice, it said, then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth gonna do what?
Mourn.
They ain't gonna be rejoicing when the Lord come back, y'all. It ain't gonna be a happy kumbaya. It's gonna be an affliction. And like we just got through reading, it said, immediately after the, a little higher rather, that there should be great tribulation, a great affliction. We're gonna read that. That's when we get to this point, like I said, there shall appear in the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. We're going to see there's the sign of the blood on the moon. We put the blood on the moon, but Israel had to put the blood on the doorpost the first time we got delivered out of
here. Amen. Amen.
So the feast, we're going to see how that feast points right direct to this. But go ahead. Go ahead. Verse 31.
And he shall send his angels with this, a great sound of a trumpet.
Oh, so we got a trumpet coming up. So we got the blood, the moon being affected. We're going to show, see that it's blood. And then we're going to see that the angels, you're going to see in his angels with a great sound of a what? A trumpet. That's a feast day. And then we're going to see why it's so great that with a great sound of a trumpet, he's going to do what? Finish that.
And they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heaven, even to the other.
Now that's going to be a gathering at the sound of this trumpet. That is a feast day. We're more blown than the trumpets, but we're going to get there. We're going to show you how all this is relevant. Let's go to Colossians, though. Let's go to Colossians 2 and 16. Because as we read, why is the moon going to be affected? Why is this trumpet coming up? And there's going to be a gathering at this trumpet. We're going to see right here that this is going to something greater in the future that's coming, that the feast days are a shadow of things to come. So let's go to Colossians 2 and verse 16. Actually, 2 and verse 8. We're going to skip down to verse 16. Because in this chapter, you got what they call Christians want to go ahead and kill the feast, not realizing that they kill it themselves, not understanding what the meaning of the Lord's holy days, or his feast days, are symbolic of. So we're going to Colossians 2 and verse 8.
Colossians 2 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and through vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ.
See, the world is off until what they call Sunday, all day tomorrow, y'all. The world is off until observing Easter Sunday. The world was off until observing Christmas. All these holidays. What about the Lord's feast, y'all?
Amen.
Now, I believe you wouldn't know it existed. I know I've been Christian for 27 years. I never heard of a Feast of Tabernacles in the Passover. What was that? So we're going to see that these are holy days, and they are shadow things to come. So Paul is addressing the philosophies of men. So now let's get down to verse 18.
Let no man beguile you of your rewards.
16.
Let no man therefore judge you in meat or drink or in respect of an holiday or the new.
That's a holy day.
Oh, forgive me. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Or of a new moon and of the Sabbath days. Which are a shadow of the things, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ.
Now wait a minute now. So these feast days, these holy days, we're going to deal with and show you how, why he said meat and drink, why he said respect of a holy day, and why he said of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are all the Lord's feast days, which are what a shadow of things to come. So he said, then notice, he said, but the body of Christ. Only people worthy to judge you are those that are part of the body of Christ. We sit back and we read this book, and that's what's going to tell who's a part of it and who's not. Okay, so now with that being said, let's go to Isaiah 25 and look at this, y'all. Isaiah 25 and verse 6. Because we're going to see this something that has yet to come. He said a shadow of things to come, so let's see this feast right here, y'all. And we're going to go and break down how each feast play an integral part in the shadow of things to come concerning the end times. Isaiah 25 and verse 6.
Isaiah 25 and 6. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things.
Interesting. A feast of fat things. Huh? Go ahead.
A feast of wine on the leaves. Fat things full of myrrh, of wine, on the leaves well refined. And he will destroy in this mountain the face of the coverings cast over all people, and the veil that is over all nations. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord will wipe away tears from off all faces.
Amen.
And the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off the earth. For the Lord has spoken it.
So wait a minute, there's a feast coming to all the people, y'all.
Amen.
This hasn't happened yet. He hasn't destroyed the covenant over all the face of all the people because they're still stuck in whatever denomination religion they in. That's a covering, y'all. And he hasn't swallowed up death yet in victory. People still dying as of right now. Okay, so this hasn't happened yet. But no, she said that he's going to make a feast unto all people of fat things, a feast of wine of the leaves, fat things of the myrrh, of wines, and the leaves of leaves well fine. These are the drinks and the meat offerings, y'all, that occur in the Lord's feast. Now, let's go quickly now. Let's go and look at the first feast, y'all. Let's go look at the first feast. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 11 chapter. First Corinthians 11. Matter of fact, I'm sorry, Leviticus 23rd. Look at the list. And what we're going to do, we're just going to go quickly down all these feasts, and then we're going to go back and just tap on how each one of them points toward the future. Leviticus 23rd chapter and verse 1.
Leviticus 23 and 1. Mm-hmm. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocation, even these are my feasts.
Now look, the Lord got feasts.
Amen.
There's a feast coming in the future that these things that we're going to read and look at down this chapter are pointing to when he's going to take off the veil off all that's covering all the people. And he's going to destroy those that destroyed the earth. That he's going to swallow up death.
Amen.
All these feasts point. That's why he said, these are my feasts. Let's look at the first one. Look. Read up, verse 3.
6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath for rest and holy convocation. Ye shall do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings.
Now, this is the first one he put at the top of the list, but I'm going to get to this one at the end because we're going to see how all the annual feasts help you get into this feast when it actually literally gets here. Okay? So now we're going to go to the annual, verse 4.
These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which shall be proclaimed in their seasons.
Mm-hmm.
And the 14th day of the first month at even is the Lord's Passover.
So now we're going to look at the Passover first, y'all. Now, we're not going to go into the past meaning of it or the present meaning, but we're going to look at what Paul was saying in his 1 Corinthians 11 chapter. Let's go 1 Corinthians 11. 11 and 22. First Corinthians 11 and 22.
1 Corinthians 11 and 23.
Mm-hmm.
For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
Now hold on, let's look at something here. This thing was done when? At night. But you see it being abused. People want to do it during the daytime. They want to do it every month, and some of them do it every week. But this thing is only done at night, and it's in remembrance. He said, you do this in remembrance of me. Now let's go quickly, right quick, to Matthew's. I'm going to go to Matthew's 26th chapter and it's going to be like he never left off from what we read. Matthew 26 and Matthew 26 and 26, then we're going to go up top.
Matthew 26, 26.
Mm-hmm.
And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and brake it,
mm-hmm,
and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body.
Now look, ain't that what we just read out what Paul was talking about?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay, sir. So now let's go at the top of this. I'm going to go to Matthew 26 and 1. Let's go to the top of this and identify what they were actually doing. And we're going to skip down through this, by the way, because I can't go into in depth. I got about 8 more days to hit. So let's go quickly to verse 2, 26 and 2.
And you know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified.
Now look, the book said right here the feast of the Passover. But we're going to need to see that also Jesus is called the Passover. And we just got to be reading, starting at the top of Leviticus 23rd chapter, it's called the feast of the what? Lord.
Amen.
But watch this. It's going to flip on us again as we get down. Skip down to verse 17.
Now the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying unto them, what will thou that we prepare for thee to eat the bread, eat the Passover.
But now turn around, called the same one the Passover, called him the unleavened bread, which Jesus is the unleavened bread.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Before we wait, say, I'm that bread of life that came down from heaven for us.
Amen. Amen.
So he is that unleavened bread because leaven represents sin. Mm-hmm. And we know it's, Jesus was the Holy One of Israel. Because there ain't no Holy One of Israel walking around here now without sin. He was the one that was without what? Sin. So now we see identify him as the unleavened bread. But watch this, verse 18.
Verse 18. And he said, go into a city to such a man and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand, and I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples.
Oh, so he's keeping the Passover with his disciples in the house.
Amen.
Okay, so now let's go back, because what I want to do is show you how between this 26th chapter and what we started out reading in 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, it's like a continuation, like Paul never left that tenor. So we just plugged into where it came from. Now we're going to go back and complete what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11. And for traction's sake, read verse 24.
1 Corinthians 11 and 24. Mm-hmm. And when they had given thanks, he break it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
So we know he's talking about the Passover. He's doing the Passover. That's right. Go ahead.
After the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had sucked, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood.
Mm-hmm.
This do ye, as oft as ye think of it, think it,
drink
it, forget it, and as oft as ye drink it,
mm-hmm.
in remembrance of me.
So now we're seeing his blood here, because his blood is the sign of the Son of Christ. That's why we are saved by his what? Blood, because if that blood would be shed, we die. We still, yet they're not sinned, had he not died for us. That's why he said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Now watch how it goes beyond this. Right, go ahead. Verse 26.
For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come.
Oh, wait a minute now. Did we start out? What's the sign of thy coming of the end of the world?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the thing that's done until he comes, which when you under this blood, it's pointing toward when the Lord comes. But go ahead, let's see what happens when Paul starts to break this thing down a little further. Go ahead.
Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord.
Oh, that's why Paul said, look, let no man judge you, because the Lord gonna judge us, y'all. Because you gotta be mindful that you gotta drink this thing worthily. Now, religion out here trying to take bites out of the Lord, but they're taking bites out of him with religion, with Christmas, with Easter. They throw his names on it. That's why it's unworthily. That's why we're going to see how Paul said, let a man examine himself. That's why you got to also examine the thoughts you have about Christ. Make sure they're coming for the word. Because when the end comes, we're going to see what the people are going to do, y'all. Everybody got Jesus now. Yeah. But are they partakers of him unworthily? Or worthy. That's what we work out each and every day with Christ. That we know. Go ahead, verse 28.
But let a man examine himself.
Yes, sir.
And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For if he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself.
Yes, sir.
Not discerning the Lord's body.
Now see, this is what's happening. People are eating and drinking this thing unworthily. They flex what they're doing, whatever they want, however they want. That's why we understand in the ordinance of the Passover, when is it done? At night. This is the only feast we can't do at no other time. We can't flip this to the day. That's why it's the second Passover, and they only take it at night. So the ordinances and everything that's concerning them, and notice he said, let a man examine himself. Not only is it the physical side of the male got to be circumcised to partake of the Passover, but he has to examine himself. Is he drinking this thing worthily? Because he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh what?
Damnation to himself.
Not discerning the Lord's body. So now, let's go into 1 Corinthians 5 and 7. Look back up to Scripture 5 and 7. Because Paul had already told the Corinthians about the Passover right here in verse 5. I'm chapter 5, and we're going to start verse 7.
Verse 7.
Mm-hmm.
Purge out therefore the old leaven.
Uh-huh.
That ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened.
Yes, sir.
For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leavening of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth.
Now look, right behind the Passover comes unleavened bread. Now, Jesus being in that Passover, Jesus' blood being a token of the new covenant, the new testament in his blood. Let's look at something right quick, y'all. Let's go all the way to Revelation 6 and 12. And watch what happens in the future. Revelation 6 and verse 12. Now, during the breaking down of the 2200 days of Daniel, we went into the seals. And now we're under the sixth seal. That's what we have right now with this verse 12. But this is a part of the 2300 days, or what we mean is occurring during the 2300 days of Daniel. So right here, verse 12, Revelation 6 and verse 12.
And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood.
Oh, wait a minute. So we see this moon, the sign that was in this period of heaven with the moon, should not give us light, is because it's turned to what? Blood. Okay, so now that sign, that's the sign of the Son of Man. And go ahead.
And the stars of heaven fell onto the earth,
mm-hmm.
even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty tree.
Yes, sir.
Mighty wind.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
And the heavens departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island removed out of their places.
Mm-hmm.
And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and every and the mighty men, and every bond man, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains.
Mm, why would they be running with the sign of the blood of Christ coming up? Why are you going to run at this time? Could have been able to drink it unworthily and partake and drink the damnation to themselves? Watch what's going to show up. Go ahead.
And said to the rocks, to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sit upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb.
Oh, the Lamb, which is Jesus.
Yeah, amen.
Yes, sir.
St. John 1 and 29 tells you, when John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which cometh to take away the sins of the what? The world.
Amen.
So that's now when they see the Lord, why they say hide us from the rocks? And his blood is up on the moon. It's because they've been taking partakers of Christ, drinking damnation to themselves. And now the wrath of the Lamb is coming. Go ahead.
For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
Now look, so now the wrath of the Lamb is coming. Let's go right into Revelation 7 chapter. Yeah. And when he brought that lamb up, remember what comes after the Passover is, and like we read in 1 Corinthians, the unleavened bread right next door.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now the blood came up. Now let's get down to verse, after go right to Revelation 7 and 1.
Revelation 7 and 1. And after these things, saw four angels standing in the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the four winds should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God.
Yes, sir.
And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea,
mm-hmm.
saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of God, the servants of our God, in their forehead.
Now let's say we're going to be sealing all the denominations and all the religious affiliations of our time. Let's mm-hmm. see what he's going to start with. Go ahead.
And I heard the number of them that were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel.
Now, wait a minute. Now, I thought it should have been the Baptists and the Methodists and the Episcopalians and the Lutherans. Now, all of that is the leaven, because the unleavened bread represents you deal with sincerity and truth, y'all. Mm-hmm. Right here, he's going to see it like the blood came up. Remember, Israel had to put the blood on the doorpost. Then they got delivered.
Mm-hmm.
So now we see the moon going up on the blood going up on the moon. Now he's still in Israel. So let's go back here and see when Israel came out of Egypt. Let's go to let's go to Leviticus 23rd chapter and show you how this relates right to the Passover.
Amen.
Leviticus 23 and verse 5. But right after the 14th day of the month, the very next day is Leviticus 23 and verse 6. Let's read that.
And on the 15th day of the same month is the Feast of Unleavened Bread.
Yes, sir.
Unto the Lord 7 days ye must eat unleavened bread.
Yes, sir.
In the first day ye shall have an holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein.
Uh-huh.
But ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord 7 days. And 7 days. And in the seventh day is a holy convocation, and you shall do no servile work therein.
Now look, in dealing with the Lord's feast, of all his feast days, this is the only feast that repeats itself. Mm-hmm. It's all unleavened bread, but why the Lord got the first day and the last day?
Right.
Why did, you know, like, man, there's no difference between the beginning and the end? Actually, there is, because that last one represents a repeat of what he did with Israel the first time. So remember we read he went to seal the tribes of Israel after that blood went up on the moon. Now he's still in the service of God. Now let's look at when Israel went out of Egypt. Let's go to Numbers 33:1. Because the first day represents the first time the Lord delivered Israel out of Egypt. Now he got to do it again. It's why we deal with the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And right here, Numbers 33:1. 33:1. Read.
These are the journeys of the children of Israel, which went forth out of the land of Egypt with their armies under the hand of Moses and Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses wrote their going out according to their journeys by the commandments of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And these are their journeys according to their goings out.
Yes, sir.
And they departed from Ramesses in the first month, on the 15th day of the first month, on the morrow after the Passover, the children of Israel went out with a high hand in the sight of all the Egyptians.
So now that they took the blood up on the doorpost, the next day is deliverance. So what's coming in the future? The Lord will throw the moon up, blood up on the moon. Guess what? Now he's selling Israel for the deliverance, the ones that make it through that 3 years of tribulation. You make it through these first 3 days, you get to the ceiling, that's your only hope if you don't make it into the wilderness. Mm-hmm. Because we can read the end of Revelation 12 chapter, everybody that keeps the commandments of God did not get into the wilderness.
That's right.
Amen, that's right.
So your only hope now is to weather them 3 years and make it to that ceiling. Mm-hmm. When he sealed the service. So now when he brought them out on the 15th day, watch this, y'all. Let's go to Isaiah 11:10. And the Lord got to do it again. It's a repeat. The Feast of Unleavened Bread is the only one that repeated itself. That's the one to understand the doctrine. You know, you got a genuine doctrine. You got to deal with sin and truth. But why did they repeat it twice? And remember, the children of Israel went back into Egypt by what? Ships. Mm-hmm. He got to deliver us what? Again. Yeah. Y'all know how hard it is. Y'all folks. Don't have to do it. Yo, folks. His bill is a load, so we can't understand why he got to do it. What? Again?
Yes, sir.
It's real as it gets.
That's right. Mm-hmm. It's real as it gets. Isaiah 11:10.
And in that day, there shall be a root of Jesse,
mm-hmm.
which shall stand for an ensign of the people.
Uh-huh.
To it shall the Gentiles see, and his rest shall be glorious.
And this is talking about the Lord. His rest going to be glorious. That's pointing toward the Sabbath day, when he actually get here. But we're going to get there. But watch what we're going for right here.
And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Which shall be left from Assyria, and from Egypt, and from Patros, and from Cush, and from Elam, and from Shinar, and from Hamar, and from the isles of the sea.
Now look, he got to do it a second time. That's why the unleavened bread repeats itself twice. So let's get down to verse 15, because it's a little more to it, but I want to keep, because I got some more to identify. So let's get down to verse 15.
And the Lord shall utterly destroy the tongue of the Egyptians at sea.
Yes, sir.
And with his mighty wind shall make his hand shake his hand over the river,
uh-huh,
and shall smite it the seven streams,
uh-huh,
and make men go over dry shod.
Good, that's why we went over in the first time when the Lord delivered. That happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, because Israel had to run, and then here come the Egyptians chasing after them, and that splitting of the Red Sea occurred before the last day of Unleavened Bread. So he had to do it again. That's why he's saying the same thing. It's a repeat. That's why I said the Lord never changed. He's saying God that's today, yesterday, and forever.
Amen.
And Israel is still out here. And it was yesterday, today, and until the Lord come back and break that veil that's upon our hearts.
Amen.
So
same game, different
place. Okay, amen. Exactly. Yep. Yep. The same game, different place, y'all. Verse 16. Mm-hmm.
And there shall be an highway for the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria, like it was to Israel in the day that he came up out of the land of Egypt.
Wait a minute, what day did the Lord say the children of Israel came up out of Egypt? On the what? 15th day. Mm-hmm. On unleavened bread. So he gonna do it again. That's what this feast is pointing toward when we keep it. When we deal with sincerity and truth, we waiting for that deliverance again. If we don't make it to that ceiling, you get in the wilderness, which all of us want to be. But if that's the case, one of us don't make it. You want to make it to that time in the ceiling.
Amen.
Like he did deliver us back then, now he's going to deliver Israel again. We can go in there a little more, but we're just trying to hit on how to feast our shadow of things to what?
Come.
Yes, sir.
So now, let's go to Revelations 11 and 8 and show that we are living in the day. We actually are in spiritual Egypt. The world is spiritual Egypt. Revelations 11 chapter. And at the top of this, it shows you the Great Tribulation period of 1,260 days. That's why we got it on the chart. We deal with that during the 2,300 days. But watch this. At verse 8, when these two witnesses are killed,
mm-hmm,
watch what it says. Everybody's gonna lie and messed up. Verse 8.
Revelations 11 and 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the streets of the great city, which is spiritually called Sodom in Egypt.
Oh, go ahead.
Where also our Lord was crucified.
Now, notice, their bodies gonna lie in a place, great city, which is spiritually called what? Sodom. Remember, the Lord rained fire and brimstone on Sodom and Gomorrah, right?
Yes, sir. They
dealt with that from the signs of last week. But why did he also say Egypt?
Yes, sir.
Because he's gonna do it again. He got to deliver us eyes. And there's plagues that are coming. Lord God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he did it before, he can do it again.
Amen.
So we got to be mindful of that. That's what these feasts are showing us toward the end times. So now, being that said, let's go and deal with Pentecost. Because, see, being witness to what we've read is what the Lord gave us, the Holy Ghost, to be witnesses of him until at such time as the end comes, y'all. And we're getting down to that right about now. Let's go to Acts 1, and I want to set up the day of Pentecost first. By going to Acts 1st chapter, and we're going to go to verse 6. Acts 1 and verse 6.
Acts 1 and 6. And when they therefore were come together, and they asked of him, saying, mm-hmm, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?
Now notice, that was the first thing they asked him. They didn't say, wilt thou take us to heaven, y'all.
Right. Okay.
So it wasn't about going up anywhere. It's about the restoration of the kingdom to Israel. But go ahead.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father hath put in his own power.
Because the Lord knew they were going to be dead when everything drops. That it does concern to show you how we're going to get back. How he's going to restore the kingdom to Israel. But watch what he does though.
But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you.
Yes, sir.
And you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth.
See, on the day of Pentecost, he poured out his power for Israel to be Jesus' witnesses. On the day of Pentecost, that's exactly what happened, to become a witness of the Lord. And like he said, to be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria unto the utmost parts of the earth. That's why if you see somebody coming up to you talking about their Jehovah's Witness, they haven't received the Spirit. Think about it. Or they tell you that Jesus is Jehovah, and they just use the wrong name. But that's another lesson. So let's go into Acts 2nd chapter and look at Acts 2 and 1, then we're going to skip down, because in the 2nd chapter, on the day of Pentecost, Peter talks about the last days, which is on the day of Pentecost. So Acts 2 and 1, let's read that, and we're going to skip down to verse 14.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there were all with one accord in one place.
So now there's a lot to go on between that, but we're going from what he spoke of on the day of Pentecost concerning what? The last day. So now let's go all the way down to verse 14.
Verse 14.
Mm-hmm.
But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my word.
Now he's full of the Holy Ghost. They've been hit the Holy Ghost between verses 2 and when we got all the way up here to verse 13. He's standing up with the Holy Ghost, bear witness to Jesus. Go ahead.
For these are not drunken as you suppose, seeing it but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel.
Oh, wait a minute. So now he went back to the prophets. Even after Jesus' death and resurrection, he said, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass in the last days, shall saith the Lord God, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream.
So now he's speaking to the house of Israel. He doesn't know all flesh gonna get hit with the spirit. But he said, and I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And notice, he's specific here. Your sons and your daughters shall what? Prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Go ahead.
But on my servants and on my handmaidens will I pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in earth beneath, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. The sun shall be turned into blood, darkness, and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord comes.
Wait a minute. So you mean to tell me on the day of Pentecost, he even showed them that this feast is pointing them to the what? The last days, the end? Beyond us?
Yes, sir.
This is what the witnesses of the Lord are letting the people know. Look, this, you got to be a witness of Jesus. You're going to survive this thing, because watch what it says, verse 21.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Ye men of Israel.
Okay, that's good. Because see, who shall call on the name of the Lord, when it comes down to the end, the name of the Lord is called the what? Also, rather, other than Jesus, the Word of God.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
It's called the Word of God. That's why when we read the blood, when the moon turned to blood, they was running away. They was running away and hiding. They started following us, hiding us from the wrath of the what? The Lamb. So now, being they were drinking unworthily, now they can't even see it in their mind to even call on the Word of God. It's whoever turned to the Word of God, them the ones that's going to be saved. That's why he said, for my name's sake, the Lord got what? The Holy One of Israel for a name, Alpha and Omega.
Redeemer,
yeah. So the one that's going to save us at this time, when this happens, is those that call on the Word of God. So, but I got a lot to hear this. So I want to walk now. Let's go to Joel and read this prophecy. Joel 2 and 28. They're showing you how these feasts point toward the end times, the last days. And the witnesses of Jesus are the ones that's going to make it. The rest of them, we'll see.
Joel 2 and 8.
Yeah, I'll skip ahead. Joel 2, and we're going to start at verse 28.
28?
Yep. So Peter talked about this, and now we're going to actually go and read right there. Read.
And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions.
Mm-hmm.
And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit.
Yes, sir.
And I will show wonders in heaven and the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke.
Mm-hmm.
The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come.
But wait a minute, that means we haven't even passed the scripture yet, have we?
No.
We got here yet.
No.
What's the year? 2017, March, what, 4th?
Allegedly.
And allegedly, right. But we ain't even got here yet.
Right.
Okay, so we still living in the days of the Holy Scriptures, okay? Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered.
Yes, sir.
For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem,
in shall, heaven and up in the clouds of the rapture.
In Mount Zion and in Jerusalem,
yes, sir,
shall be delivered.
Yes, sir.
As the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call.
Now those here the prophets, so in the remnant whom the Lord called. It's going to be, remember we read earlier, the captives and the kings, and all people saying, let the rocks fall on us. A lot of people are going to be saying that, because they've been partakers of the Passover, trying to get into partakers of Jesus, unworthy, and they've been drinking damnation to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to get down to it. That's why, hey, we come up in here, it's a small crowd. Yes, sir, it's going to be a remnant compared to that rock star crowd that's lining up to go in there tomorrow, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he said a remnant. Whom the Lord shall call him. We represent that. Because we keep the Lord's Pentecost and the feast and his Passover.
Amen. Amen.
See what I'm saying? So now we're preparing ourselves for this time.
Hallelujah.
So now let's go to the trumpet. Now let's go to let's go to Leviticus. I gotta remember the bounce in there. Leviticus 23rd chapter. I should have said put a mark in there. Anyway. Sorry about that, dog. Yeah, put a mark in Leviticus 23rd chapter. Because we're bouncing back and forth. Because all of these feast had yet to be actually fulfilled or complete. That's why he said we do show the Lord's death till he comes. The Passover is kept until the Lord comes.
Amen.
The Feast of Unleavened Bread represents when Israel gets actually delivered out of this. And then in the creation aspect, did I drop that on him? No, he ain't gonna go there just yet. Let me go on. But there's a bigger aspect to that. But let's go to Leviticus 23 and 23. Leviticus 23:23.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first day of the month, you shall have a Sabbath, a memorial blowing of trumpets and holy convocation.
Now look, it says memorial blowing of the trumpets and holy convocation. Now we're going to see that in the end times, in the last day, in the last day, you want to be in the holy convocation we're going to read about right now. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians 4:13. 2 Thessalonians 4:13. Because when Jesus came, can anybody read what Jesus blew a trumpet?
Mm-mm.
A literal trumpet. Nope. So this feast here, this trumpet here, that we're going to read about, watch it, 1 Thessalonians. I got the wrong number on there. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. This holy convocation, this is the one that all of us want to be in right here, y'all. 4:13. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Read.
But I would not have you to be in the brethren concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which also sleep in Jesus will God bring with us.
Yes, sir.
For this we say unto you by the word of God, uh-huh, by the word of the Lord,
uh-huh,
that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep.
Oh, so we're talking about the coming of the Lord, huh? Well, Jesus, they ask him, what shall be the sign that I come in at the end of the world? So what we're reading is very pertinent to the end times, ain't
it? Yes.
We can identify that same time period. Let's see what's going to happen. Read.
For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep.
Uh-huh.
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first.
Oh, so this is trumpet that's coming, this great trumpet that we read about in Matthew 24 chapter, when he asked the Lord, what shall be the sign of our coming of the end of the world? This is the great trumpet. Why? Because when this trumpet sounded, it said the what? They called it the trump of God. Then it said the dead in Christ shall what?
Rise first.
It rise first.
Now watch this, y'all. Read the next verse.
Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord.
What could be a more holy convocation than that? Amen. How many of y'all want to miss this? You wouldn't miss that?
I ain't trying to.
Okay. This is a holy gathering. This is what we read in Leviticus 23 and 23, y'all. This is the one you want to be in.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, God forbid, if one of us drop dead next week or tomorrow night or tonight, however, we know this is the one you're looking for.
Amen.
You're looking for this, every last one of them.
Yes.
And that's why he said in the very next verse, read that last verse, 18.
Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Because we're looking for the fulfillment of this trumpet to be blown, this great trumpet. Should I pass, his brother pass, his sister pass? Hey, we comfort one another with these words while we lie, because we know at this holy convocation, this feast, we're going to see each other again.
Amen. Amen.
And watch how Paul even puts it. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15 and 52.
Verse 52.
I got this new book and the pages be sticking. I'm like, I gotta break her in. Okay, verse 52.
1 Corinthians 15 and 52.
Oh, sorry, verse 51.
51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed.
See, look, remember Paul said those that sleep in the Lord? So we're talking about that same, this is the same precept. Watch how Paul break it down. Go ahead.
In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall raise incorruptible. And we shall be changed.
Yes, sir.
For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality.
Yes, sir.
Amen, amen.
So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory.
Oh, let me read in Isaiah 25th chapter, y'all.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's a day of victory for the saints.
Amen.
When that trumpet sound, that last trump sound, it is a day that for us, death is swallowed up in victory. Go ahead. Verse 55.
O death, where is that sting? O grave, where is that victim?
That's why we believe in keeping this trumpet, this field. That's what the trumpet is pouring to. Because we realize death ain't going to have this victory over us.
Amen.
We've been observing the feast that point toward, which are shadow things to come, when we all going to get this victory.
Amen.
Amen.
That day, that first day of the seventh month.
Amen.
See, so now, amen, let's go to Revelation 8th chapter right quick to show you why he said the last trumpet. Revelation 8 and verse, we was on the bus stop and this Gentile was trying to say it can happen at any time. When I read that to him, he looked like, that's going to be seven trumpets. Yeah. Revelation 8 and verse 1. Then we'll skip down to verse 6. So Revelation 8 and 1.
When he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of a half an hour. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, to them were given seven angels.
Oh,
seven
trumpets. Now we understand why Paul said at the last what? Trump. Because you got seven trucks to start. But I asked what I said, if they're the last truck, they must be the first truck.
That's right, that's right.
Okay, so we see a total of seven trumpets were given to seven angels. And now let's get down to verse 6.
Verse 6. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound.
So now we ain't gonna go into how what's each event. We dealt with that already, and when we dealt with 2,200 days of Daniel. But we see here that these seven angels got a sound, and when they prepare themselves to sound, there's gonna be events that's gonna be occurring. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that's why the priest is pointing toward, man, look, you getting ready for that last trump. But you don't want to be involved with the first six trumpets, because there's some trouble on that. But that's another lesson, y'all. So let's go to right. Yeah, that's why you gotta make it to that holy convocation. That's why you keep it now on the first day of the 7 months. You show them, look, I'm gonna be in that last trump. One thing when you the dead in Christ raised at the trump of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay? So right here in Revelation 11 and 15.
Revelation 11 and 15. Mm-hmm. And the seven angels sounded, and there was a voice in heaven. There were voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. And he shall reign forever and ever.
Now notice, when the seven trumpets sound, we know this is the last what? Trump. Mm-hmm. We know this is that trump that's in 1 Thessalonians 4th chapter. Mm-hmm. So now let's get down to verse 18.
Verse 18, and the nations were angry, and that wrath is come, and the time of the dead.
Oh, so now the text is right there to Thessalonians, don't it? Because when that trumpet of God sounds, the dead of Christ shall what?
Rise
first. Which is representative, like Paul said, and it's saying here, this is the time of the what? Also
dead.
The dead.
Yep.
That's why it's such a holy convocation. Go ahead.
And they should be judged, mm-hmm. And that thou shouldest give them rewards of give rewards unto thy servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and to them that fear thy name, small and great.
Uh-huh.
And shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth.
Oh, takes them right back to the Isaiah 25th chapter when he's going to be dealing with the world. And when we read Isaiah 25:6-8. Because right here, not only is it the time of the dead, it's time that they should be judged and we should get our reward. But he's also going to deal with them that what? Destroys the earth. Which is going to be a great affliction on the rest of the earth. Actually, the Lord, when we dealt with the 2,300 days, he afflicted the world all over. But when this trumpet sounds, that's when they're going to take it. It's going to be straight over. Mm-hmm. But look, let's go to our last okay, let's go to the next day, y'all. So let's go to Leviticus 23rd chapter. Back to Leviticus 23 and verse 26. Because after the trumpet comes the day of affliction, or the day of atonement.
Amen.
The day of confession, the day that we put it on the line, we suffer now, or afflict our souls now. Because guess what? The day coming, Lord, will afflict this world with an affliction that such as never heard of. And this is what the feast of the day of atonement, or the day of affliction, is also pointed toward in the end time. There's a little more to it even in the present day meeting, but I'm not trying to harp on that. We're dealing with the end time and the shadow of that which is to come. So right here, 23 and verse 26.
23:26.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, on the 10th day of the 7th month, there shall be a day of atonement.
Yes, sir.
And shall be an holy convocation unto you, and you shall afflict your souls in offering made by fire unto the Lord.
Yes, sir.
You should do no work there in the same day, in that same day. Forgive me. You shall do no work in that same day, for it is a day of atonement.
Yes, sir.
To make an atonement for you.
Amen.
Before the Lord your God.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
And whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, he shall be cut off from among his people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And whatsoever soul it shall be that doeth any work in that same day,
mm-hmm.
the same show will I destroy from among his people.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to see this got a clear end time meaning. Go ahead.
You shall do no manner of work.
Mm-hmm.
It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
And it shall be unto you a Sabbath rest.
Yes, sir.
And you shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month. at even, from even to even, shall ye celebrate your Sabbath.
Now watch this. Let's see what this is pointing toward, y'all. Let's go to Mark 13 chapter. It's a time of affliction. It's when we afflict our souls, and then souls that would not, need the Lord on this floor. So we're going to go to Mark 13 and 14. Watch what this is going to do. Mark 13 chapter. And we're going to see that we never left Mark 20 from Matthew 24 chapter. So we're going to start there. Mark 13 and verse 14.
Mark 13 and 14.
Mm-hmm.
But when you shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing where he ought not, let him that readeth understand.
Yes, sir.
Then let them which be in Judea flee to the mountain.
Yes, sir.
And let him that is on the housetop not go down into his house, neither enter therein to take anything out of his house.
So that's almost like we're repeating Matthew 24 chapter again, eh?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In time. But watch how the Lord describes the Great Tribulation period this time. Skip down to verse 19.
For in those days shall be affliction.
Shall be what?
Affliction.
Affliction. Go ahead.
Such as was not from the beginning of the creation, which God created unto his time, neither shall be.
Oh, so now we see the time of affliction gonna come. And when this Great Tribulation hit, it's gonna be a lot of destruction going on.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna read some more about that, because that's what these end times, rest of the feast, are pointing to. How the Lord dropping affliction on the earth, how he's dropping the trumpets afflicting the earth. Everything is just cascading right down to the last trunk till we get to the Feast of Tabernacles. What? This affliction is gonna come upon the whole world. But all the service of God that we were afflicting our souls not so we can escape this.
Amen.
This is why we do it now, so that when you have to get here, you want to be sealed or you want to be in the wilderness. A or B, you know, or dead, I put it like that. Dead, in the wilderness, or under that seal when the Lord, when this affliction comes.
Yes, sir.
So now, let's go and look at the time that this act is going toward. Let's go to Jeremiah 16 and 19. Jeremiah 16 chapter, verse 19, because the day of atonement is also where you confess your sins to the high priest.
That's right.
Lay hands on the ghost to confess all the sins of the children of Israel. But watch what the Gentiles will do, y'all. 16 and verse 19.
Jeremiah 16 and 19. Mm-hmm. Oh Lord, my strength and my fortress and my refuge in a day of affliction. The Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth, and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanities, and things wherein there is no profit.
No, it's just saying, in the day of what? Affliction. Then the Lord said, on the day of affliction, we got to afflict our souls.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a part of confession. Yep. So now, when the Lord break the Gentiles down, on the 10th day after the Lord came back, that seventh trumpet of the sound, then they're going to do what? They're going to confess, look, that shall say, surely our fathers have inherited what?
Lies,
vanities, and things where there's no what?
Profit.
To keep them out of the lake of fire. That's what's going on now. All day tomorrow. That's what religion is full of lies and vanities. No profit to keep you out of the lake of fire. It's a sign of action. Put you in the lake of fire, okay? So now let's move on to the next one, the Feast of Tabernacles. So let's go to Leviticus 23 and 33. Because all these feasts have a past, present, and future meaning, but we're showing you the shadow of things to come.
Amen.
You know, we're going in depth a little bit more on the actual day that we do these feasts, or like in our ministry, we go and show you actually all three aspects, the past and the present day meaning, so that people understand we ain't just keeping them feasts just to walk in it, just to do it on that day, but it represents your walk with the Lord.
Amen.
Between the feast days.
Amen.
So, with that said, let's go to 23 and 33.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the seventh month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord.
Now notice, this is on the 15th day of the seventh month. So now after we don't have the Lord sound that trumpet, the Gentiles come up and confess, guess what? The tabernacles actually represent the presence of the Lord. Being his word now, that's what it's for us today. Being full of his his word now, because when the Lord come back, the earth will be full of his glory in his mouth, because it ain't full of it now, y'all.
Amen.
But let's go to Zechariah 14 chapter and show you when the Lord is at his presence. Zechariah 14 and verse 1. Zechariah 14 and verse 1. And then we're going to skip that.
Zechariah 14 and 1. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoils shall be divided in the midst of thee.
Mm-hmm.
For I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, uh-huh. and the city shall be taken, and the houses rifles, and the women ravaged. And half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city.
Mm-hmm.
Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations, as when he fought in the day of battle.
That's why when we read Revelation 11 chapter, verse 18, the time of his wrath is coming. And we know how that battle will end, y'all.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you see, Independence Day was kind of like that. That's kind of giving you a clue. Okay? I don't want to scare somebody. I want them to, petrified, scared. They're scared. Look, the fear of the Lord is beginning with them now. Okay?
I do not want to be a rock star. Okay.
Yes, sir. So, yeah, that's a clue, y'all.
Yes, sir.
So, right here now, verse 4. Go ahead.
Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle.
Yes, sir.
And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives,
mm-hmm.
which is before Jerusalem on the east.
Mm-hmm.
And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great battle. And half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azar.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzzah, king of Judah, and the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with him.
Oh, so now we see the dead of Christ that been raised up. Now we've met the Lord in the air. Now we're coming back to the earth.
Amen.
Amen.
For what? Feast of Tabernacles.
That's right.
Reflected the word. Then a Gentile that came up and confessed. Now, read the next verse.
And it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall be clear nor dark.
Mm.
But it shall be one day which shall be known to the Lord, not day nor night.
Mm.
But it shall come to pass that at evening time it shall be light.
Let me show y'all right quick about that. This is where we actually enter into the Sabbath. Let's hold this spot and let's go to Genesis right quick. Genesis, first chapter. I wonder when I should drop it in there, but I want y'all to point something out. When you go to Genesis 1, okay, we're going to go to Genesis 1 and 1, then we're going to skip down to verse 5.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day.
Now look, the Lord created the light, and then he said, he called night, called darkness night, and he knows, he said the evening and the morning is what?
First day.
Skip down to verse 8.
Verse 8. God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day.
Hmm, interesting. So he said it again, right? The evening and morning, the second day, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, skip down to verse 13.
And the evening and morning were the third day.
And now he had brought forth all the herbs and the grass, yielding fruit and all that. So he said the evening and morning was the third day. Okay, skip down to verse 19, because he had brought forth the sun and the moon now. Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the fourth day.
No, it's a consistent pattern here. Evening and the morning. You count, we're going evening and morning, first day, evening and morning, second. Now we're on evening and morning, the fourth day, right?
Yes.
Let's go to verse 23.
And the evening and morning were the fifth day.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. He keep repeating it, right? Every time he does something, we see evening and the morning, right? Okay, let's skip all the way down. We brought man in the sixth day. Go ahead.
Verse 31. And God saw everything that he made, mm-hmm. and behold.
Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the sixth day.
Now I'm going to bring this up. Let's show people can see here too. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Right there.
Right there. When God created man, he created, came down to the sixth day. All this, he said, even in the morning was the sixth day. He got all the hands when he brought man forth on the first day, right? Yeah. Then he said, man got 7 days to work to get to the Sabbath. Well, let's make sure that we're gonna see something amazing happening. Remember, we read in Zechariah 14th chapter that it says, be a day known unto the Lord, not day nor night, no evening or what? In other words, there's no evening in the morning then, right? Let's go right into Genesis 2 and verse 1.
Genesis 2 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made.
Mm-hmm.
And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work, which he had created and made.
Did anybody notice what was missing?
The evening and the morning.
Oh, so that hadn't been there. So that means we haven't gotten to this day yet.
Huh?
Right, we ain't even got to the seventh day yet.
Oh, wow.
No, man. Yeah, it hasn't arrived yet. That's why I said, now we go back to Zechariah 14 chapter. Because we haven't gotten to the end yet, y'all, for man.
Oh, wow.
This is what, or the end of the kingdoms of man as they have it now. Because the Lord will shut it down. So now when we go back and pick it up right at Zechariah 14 and verse 6, read that.
Zechariah 14 and 6. And it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear, nor dark.
Mm-hmm.
It shall be one day which shall be known to the Lord, mm-hmm. not day nor night, mm-hmm. but it shall come to pass that at evening time it shall be light.
Just arrived into the Sabbath. Just got, that's what that was symbolic of. That's representing the end. Because watch where we go. Watch where we go from here, y'all. Go skip down to verse 16.
And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem.
That's an affliction. Everybody that's alive, that affliction when the Lord ravaged the earth. Go ahead.
Shall even go up from year to year to worship the king, the Lord of hosts, and keep the feast of tabernacles.
Also, they come and keep the feast of tabernacles because the Lord
yes,
is
sir.
Here. It's
yes,
like for us right now, because his word is present in us, we represent his tabernacles now.
Hallelujah.
How that gets a little more. Let's go, I'm going to get there, but let's go to Daniel 2 and 31 and show you how this tabernacle represents us being filled with his word. Because I can't stand up here and tell y'all any old thing and come off the top of my head how I feel or what I feel.
Not
why? Because the presence of the word of God here.
Amen. His amen, brother.
His presence. So when the feast is fulfilled, he will be here, literally.
Amen. Right. Amen.
See, right now, his spirit is here. And we represent that tabernacle.
Amen.
Amen.
So right here
amen.
In Daniel 2 and 3, watch what he's going to do to man, though. Daniel 2 and 31. Daniel 2 and right to 31. Because he showed the Gentile Nebuchadnezzar a dream, and it's represented something right here that the feast points toward when the Lord come back. Did we actually finish that Zechariah 14? Because I want to finish that. I'm sorry, let's go back to Zechariah 14. I want to finish that. And then I'm going to make this point in Daniel 2. So hold that Daniel 2. Go back to Zechariah, and y'all see what I mean. When we go into this Daniel 2nd chapter, it's going to the full effect of what happens in Zechariah 14 chapter when we realize.
Agreed.
See, so we read verse 16. They're gonna come to from notice year to year. I want y'all to keep that in mind. Year to year to worship the King, the Lord of Hosts, and to keep the feast of tabernacles. Go ahead. Verse 17.
Mm-hmm.
And
it shall come, and it shall be that whosoever will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King and the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rest.
Yes, sir.
And if the families of family of Egypt go not up and come not, that have no rain,
mm-hmm.
there shall be a plague wherewith the Lord will smite the heathens that come not up to keep the feast of tabernacles.
So what does that mean for the churches that come out? You don't have to keep it now. They are not keeping. They're heathenism.
Yes.
They represent Egypt.
Woo.
But you're not even delivered out of. That's what they into now. So the Lord's going to smite them. And right here we're seeing, for our sake, for those of us that keep it now, we understand what the Feast of Tabernacles represents when he comes back. He's going to be here because this is made for everyone. Verse 19, read.
Verse 19. This shall be the punishment of Egypt and the punishment of all nations that come not up to keep the Feast of Tabernacles.
Mm-hmm.
In that day shall there be upon the bales of the horses holiness unto the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And the pots in the Lord's house shall be like the bowls before the altar.
See, because he's going to be here. Like his word is present, his spirit on his word is present in us. Well, God is in us now.
Amen.
So now, let's go. Now let's go to Daniel 2 and 31.
Daniel 2 and 31.
Mm-hmm.
Thou, O king, saw and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee. And the form thereof was terrible.
Now look. Daniel was breaking this dream down so that his brother, so that Nebuchadnezzar could understand, because he wanted an interpretation of the dream. Just give you a little background. So he said, thou, king, saw the image thou saw was a great image, this whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. Go ahead.
This is the image head was of fine gold, and his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, and his feet part of clay, part of iron and part of clay.
Now this was a statue of a man representing the entire Gentile dynasty from beginning to the end. Because watch what happens, y'all. Go ahead. Verse 34.
Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet, that were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces. Then was the iron and the clay and the brass, the silver and gold broken to pieces together, and became like the shape of the summer threshing floor.
Yes, sir.
And the wind carried them away.
Uh-huh.
That there was no place found for them.
Yes, sir.
And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth.
Oh, and it filled the earth.
Yes,
and
it did.
Represent Christ, that stone that the builders have put at naught. He's gonna strike the Gentiles at the feet, because guess what's left now at this point in time? Only their feet, y'all. Because Nebuchadnezzar, Babylon, that golden image, that silver part, all, and that's in the historical part, all that's passed away. Now we in the days, the last days, the end times, where they're going to come find themselves hiding from this stone that's going to hit this earth, or hit there, take down the Gentile dynasty. And notice, the key word here is that they fill the what? The whole earth. Like when the Lord come back and the tabernacles hit the earth, and when the Lord's here and we keep in the feast of tabernacles, he says it's going to be holiness unto the Lord, because they're going to be what we see now. Okay? So just to further reinforce that, let's go now to Colossians 1 and 9 to show you how we are representatives of that now in Colossians 1 and 1 I want to start in the one in Colossians 1 and 8.
Colossians 1 and 8. Who also declare unto us your love in the Spirit. For this cause we also, since the day we heard of it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will, and all wisdom and spiritual understanding.
See, look, now we getting this, but the earth gonna be filled with the knowledge of the Lord. Let's go read that, y'all. Let's go to Isaiah 11 chapter. That's why I say they filled the earth, and the tabernacle represented us being filled with the word of God. And right here, Isaiah 11, and then we'll start up a little higher. Yeah, start at Isaiah 1.
Isaiah chapter 1, 11 and 1. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, and the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of fear of the Lord.
See, all of this is what we want us in us now. Because guess what? The Lord will bring this to the earth then.
Amen.
So to what the Feast of Tabernacles is pointing to. That's why it's asking for 7 days, because for them 7 days, these should be the spirits coming out of you.
Amen.
Because when you around your brothers and sisters, you know, on Saturday, it's just, what, 1 day. But what about for the rest of the 6 days of the week?
Amen.
You got the Feast of Tabernacles going for 7 days, so as you around your brothers and sisters, you start to see how these spirits, the spirit of wisdom, counsel, fear of the Lord, all this manifests itself for them 7 days.
Amen.
And that next day, the eighth day, that's a day of judgment.
That's right.
That day, look, you're going to be like, ain't nobody singing on that day, y'all. Okay?
It's on a Sunday.
Yeah.
It's a Sunday.
So, keep going. Verse 3.
Mm-hmm. And shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ear.
Uh-huh.
But with righteousness shall he judge the poor,
yes, sir,
and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth.
Yes, sir.
And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked.
Let go of that affliction. Mm-hmm. He said, "Who's going to afflict so he's going to cut off. He's going to destroy them. Let me destroy some among their people." Go ahead.
And the righteous shall be as a girdle of his loins, and faithfulness as a girdle of his raiment.
Mm-hmm.
The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion, and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them.
Now we know this ain't happened yet, y'all. They're trying to sit over there and fake it. But you know, how many of y'all put y'all babies out there? I mean, how many you seen a cow lay with a bear? A leopard lie down with a kid, and a calf with a young lion, you go put them out there right now.
You must want your kid to lie down right now, too.
And read verse 8, go ahead.
And a suckling child shall play on the hole of an ass.
Who's going to dare? They will put you in there for child abuse now.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Straight jacket and jail. And removal of child. Okay? Because this ain't came to pass yet. This is what the feast shadow of things to come. Go ahead.
And a suckling child shall play on the hole of an ass, and the winged child shall put his hand on a cockatrice den.
Mm-hmm.
There shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
See, at that time, when the presence of the Lord is going to be full of what?
The knowledge of the Lord.
We're full of it now, of the knowledge of the Lord. You know, we're striving, you know, to increase in more understanding what the world ain't there yet. But when the feast acts, then the feast time and its fulfillment, the shadow of what it's pointing to come, is earth going to be full of the knowledge of the Lord. That's why they're going to be coming up there, keeping the Feast of Tabernacles. And it's going to be holiness to the Lord, not Christmas trees and bunny rabbits and Easter eggs. Okay?
Amen.
So now, let's go to Isaiah 66 and 15.
Isaiah 66 and 15.
Mm-hmm.
For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind, to render his anger with fury and his roof with the flame of fire.
Yes, sir.
And by fire, by his sword, will the Lord plead with all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many.
Look, y'all, a lot of people are going to die. The flesh is going to be heavy. And when the trumpet gets through blowing, and when the Lord comes with his fire, he said the slain of the Lord will be many. Go ahead.
They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh and the abomination, and a mouse shall be consumed together, saith the Lord.
Hey, I think that's a Christmas tree, y'all. Anyway. Yeah, but I know that's that tree that Satan wrapped himself around, sit up there telling him, you eat that swine, and you might as well throw that mouse on the plate, too. Okay? But watch this, verse 18.
For I know their works and their thoughts, and it shall come to pass that I will gather all nations in tongues, and they shall come and see my glory.
Mm-hmm.
And I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape of them unto the nations, to Tarshish, to Nepal, and Lud, to draw up the bow to Tubal and Javan, to the isles afar, to that have not heard
mm-hmm.
my fame,
mm-hmm.
neither seen my glory.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall declare my glory among the Gentiles.
Uh-huh.
And they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations, upon horses, in chariots, and in leaders, and upon mules, and upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain, Jerusalem.
Oh, I thought we were supposed to go to heaven, y'all. Or the marriage of the Lamb is supposed to be in heaven. Now, it's going to be, we being brought to Jerusalem. Go ahead.
Saith the Lord, as the children of Israel brought an offering in a clean vessel into the house of the Lord. And I will also take of them for priests and for Levites, saith the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And as the new heaven and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain.
We know this ain't came to pass yet, y'all. The new heaven and the new earth has not occurred. And remember, we said, what we read in Colossians said, let no man judge you drink or meat or inspect of a holiday or a new moon. Watch this, y'all. Go ahead.
It shall come to pass that from one new moon to another,
that's year to year, we read that in Zechariah. Year to year, the new moon that sets off the year, year to year, new moon to new moon, and then what?
And from one Sabbath to another,
yes, sir,
shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me, for their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an abhorrence unto all
men. Oh, wait a minute now. So you got some people that's going to end up in the lake of fire during this time? The men that have transgressed against the Lord. So let's go back to this tabernacle and look one more time at some of y'all. I'm sleeping somebody. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians 1 and 7. Then we're going to go back for the last piece of this. 2 Thessalonians, brother. 2 Thessalonians 1 and 7. 2 Thessalonians 1 and 7.
2 Thessalonians 1 and 7.
Because all these feasts are shadow things to come. Go ahead.
And to you who are troubled, rest with us.
Uh-huh.
When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven, which is mighty angel, and flames of fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh, so when we read that, the prophet saying the Lord will be coming in flames of fire, taking vengeance with his fury, and destroying them that eat swine with have a tree in their midst. These are the ones that don't know God. So ignorance is dangerous, y'all. Real now, if I tell everybody, I'll be like, no, we said Jacob said Jack. You read this book for yourself, because you got to get yours, and I got to get mine. You got to know the Lord for yourself. That's why he's saying flame and fire, take a vengeance on them that do what?
Know not God.
And if you don't know that Christ is the Passover, you got that unleavened bread to the witness of Jesus, and you wait for that trumpet, and you're 50 years old now, because you don't want to get afflicted later. That's all you're going for, not knowing God. Those things show you his end time, how he's going to come to this point to destroy them that know not God, and then on the other side of the left of life, obey not the gospel. That's where the tabernacle shows the fruits of the Spirit. We bring food because we're feeding people the things to be of Christ, not the things to be of my flesh, to be of wickedness. Well, we're supposed to exhibit the fruits of Christ. But that's another lesson. That's why I couldn't go in deep in every last piece of it. But this is coming, and watch what's going to happen in verse 9.
Verse 9.
Mm-hmm.
Even him whose coming is.
No, you were one. One of
them. One of them. I was okay.
Yeah, he was a bright man.
Forgive me. Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And from the glory of his power, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints.
Yes, sir.
And to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day.
Also, this presence of God being in us now is going to be reflected when he comes to we die in Christ. You know what I'm saying? When he comes, then he's going to be glorified. What? It said he's just going to be glorified in the saints and be admired by doing what? Changing us over. And we're going to keep, that's why I said, all the saints will come with him, and we're going to come, and we're going to be keeping a feast of tabernacles, which represent his presence. That's why I said, they're going to be destroyed from the destruction of the presence of the Lord, and from the glory of his power, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints, and to be admired in all them that what? Believe.
Amen.
Because Amen. Our testimony was a believed among you, was believed, rather, in that day, even in this day, y'all. Okay? So now let's go. Now let's go to now I want to go back to Leviticus 23rd chapter, because we read in that tabernacles that you're gonna come up and see men in the what, in fire that's quenched not. Mm-hmm. They're gonna be abhorred to all flesh. You're gonna walk up to the feast of tabernacles. We're gonna look over there. Ooh, especially those that's in the flesh. They're gonna look like, man, why them guys in that? We're gonna be right now. Leviticus 23 and verse
talk about a hot day.
So now we're gonna go Leviticus 23 and 33 just for traction's sake, just for reference sake. Start back over at the 33. This time we're gonna read all the way down, and we're gonna notice a fire that's gonna burn for 7 days. Let's see what we do with this fire for 7 days. We'll see it right here. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the 7th month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord.
Remember, this Feast of Tabernacles is for 7 days. Okay, go ahead.
On the first day shall be a holy convocation. You should do no servile work therein.
Uh-huh.
7 days shall ye offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. On the 8th day shall be a holy convocation unto you. You shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord.
Uh-huh.
It is a solemn assembly. You shall do no servile work therein.
Now notice, he makes a distinction here. 7 days you shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. Then he says, on the 8th day shall be a holy convocation unto you. You shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly. Why is it a solemn assembly? And you shall do no servile work therein. Let's skip down to get right to the point. Let's get down to verse 39.
Also, in the 15th day of the 7th month, when you have gathered in the fruit of the land, you shall keep a feast unto the Lord 7 days.
Mm-hmm.
On the first day shall be a Sabbath, and on the 8th day it shall be a Sabbath.
Skip down to verse 41.
41.
Mm-hmm.
And you shall keep it a feast unto the Lord 7 days in a year. In a year.
Mm-hmm. I skipped verse 40.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you shall take you on the first day a bough of goodly trees and branches of palm and a bough of thick trees and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God 7 days.
How come he didn't say 8 days, y'all? They're right next to each other. Why didn't he say rejoice for 8 days? But remember, he called the 8th day a solemn assembly. That's not a day of rejoicing. Because when we went into the Feast of Tabernacles, when we go into the Feast of Tabernacles, when the Lord come back, and we go look at them people, the men that transgress against them, and let fire, you're going to be like, this. Then the Lord said, they're going to be abhorrent to all flesh. So we ain't going to want to be over there, but we're like, no, we don't want to see that judge.
Right.
That represents that judge, that represents the fire of the 8th day. He just giving the people in the 7th day. The Sabbath day, when they actually get here, a preview of what's coming in the 8th day.
Yes,
and the Lord always prepares people. He always shows, even at that time when the Lord comes on the flesh and blood here. So they're going to be looking and giving a chance to see, hey, you transgress against me? Go look over there and see the men that transgress against me during this first 7 days.
No thank you, no thank you.
Okay, during the first 6 days, rather. Look at them and see what they got. You want some of that?
No.
You're going to be like, you're going to be like, purging, okay, you don't want none of that.
None of that.
Okay, that's why I asked that. So now, he said, we rejoice for 7 days. Go ahead.
What's he said?
Mm-hmm.
He said, you shall keep it a feast unto the Lord 7 days in a year. In the year, he says, it shall be a statute forever in your generation.
Mm-hmm.
You shall celebrate it in the 7th month.
Now look, let's go to our last place, y'all. Let's go to Revelation 20th chapter. Close out with the last feast. Revelation 20. And it all rolls up right here. Our last place, Revelation 20th chapter. gonna start at verse 4. I'm sorry, verse 1. Revelation 21, we're gonna bump it down.
Revelation 21. And I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit, mm-hmm. and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, mm-hmm. and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled.
Now look, I want to point something out on this chart. This is what this all pointed down to. We're coming down to the seventh day. Go ahead, keep reading.
And
verse 4.
And I saw I saw thrones, and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. Mm-hmm. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus.
Wait a minute. Didn't Jesus say the Pentecost is for the witness of what? You shall be witnesses unto who? Me?
Yep.
Another word of God.
Yes, sir.
That's what the seventh day is pointing to, the word of God.
Yes, sir.
All anybody that come down and has been found worthy, you come up in that, you give them judgment because you bear witness to Jesus and the word of God and what else?
And worship, which had not worshiped the beast, neither his image, neither received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands.
Now hold on. You gotta walk around with this. You gotta walk around with this. Because these people that walk around with this don't believe in keeping the feast. Ask them about the Passover. Ask them about the unleavened bread. Ask them about the Pentecost. They're gonna mess that all up. Ask them about, you know, about the trumpets. Ask them about, do you believe in the Day of Atonement? Ask them about the Feast of Tabernacles. Everybody walk around with that. Because they're not part of. They're not part of the Lord's people. That's gonna come up in this day, y'all. The beast, because they worshiping the beast. The beast don't believe in keeping today's order. It's saying tomorrow. But go ahead.
Neither have received their mark upon their foreheads, mm-hmm. or in their hands, mm-hmm. and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years.
This is the day of rest that this is pointing to.
Amen.
We're
going definitely, but I'm just tapping on the Sabbath day as we close out. Because if we got the seventh day, what comes after the number seven?
Number eight.
That's what the eighth day is pointing to. This right here, this day of judgment. Go ahead.
But the rest of the day lived not again until 1,000 years were finished.
Uh-oh.
This is the first resurrection.
See, we try to get into that first resurrection, which the trumpet is pointing.
Amen.
Amen.
So we can be in the feast of what? Tabernacles.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, sir.
He's going to bring Israel to the tabernacles. Because he gave it to us in the wilderness, and he's going to bring it right back. This is why the feast point to a shadow of things to come. Go ahead.
Blessed and holy is he that have part in the first resurrection. On such, the second death have no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years.
That's why every time we read in Leviticus 23rd chapter, he said this is a holy one.
Convocation.
Yes, sir.
Blessed is he, blessed and holy is he. And you want to keep all those things that are holy, so you could be counted as what? Blessed and holy.
Amen.
Be blessed not to be under the worship of the beast.
Amen.
Amen.
You were blessed when you removed this out of my house.
Amen.
Out of his house. I don't know if you had it in your house.
Amen.
Oh, okay, praise the Lord. So when you were blessed when you got rid of this mark. Okay? But he said, bless the Holy Spirit that have part in what? First through the wretch. On such as the second death have no power, but they shall be what? Priest of God and of Christ. No, there ain't no third person in them. And shall reign with him in what?
In 1,000 years.
Now let's see what happens now. Go ahead.
But the rest of the dead live not again until 1,000 years.
Verse 7.
Yeah. And when 1,000 years were expired, Satan shall be loosed out of this prison.
After the Sabbath day. After 1,000 years. Now we got Satan loose, like he loose now. All day tomorrow. You think I'm trying? Look, going there with the law. Go in there and talk to them about the Pentecost or the Passover or the unleavened bread. I'll give you about 20 minutes. I'll be like, I think we come in there so quick. And you thought I was long clean. Can you read the book? Yeah. Okay. But the rest of the day, because Satan is loosed in there, he's going to be loosed after the seventh day. Go ahead. Verse 8.
And shall go out and deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, God, may God, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom as the sand of the sea.
Now look, I got to point this out right quick. But first day Satan deceived us. When we, in the sixth day, man's first day we was deceived. It's going to be a repeat, y'all. The day after Saturday, like after now, people are deceived. You know, we trying to save as many as we can, show them, you know, hey, this is not the way, brother. The Lord's way is the Sabbath, or it's a feast day. We show them his feast. So now it's going to be a repeat, y'all. So now, in the eighth day, he loosed to deceive the nation. Go ahead.
God and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number as whom as the sand of the sea.
Uh-huh.
And they went up on the breadth of the earth to compass the camp of the saints about the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven to devour and devoured them.
Oh, on the eighth day, so you got God on the earth already, but then fire comes from God out of heaven. So that means you got one on the earth, and the other one is yet to come.
Yep.
Fire ain't came down yet, y'all. Go ahead.
It's fire here, though.
Okay, it's fire came down, but it's not him. Go ahead.
And the devil that deceived them were cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, which were where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever.
Oh, now we identify who Isaiah 66, the last verse, was talking about. The man that had transgressed against me. It said, who? Where the beast and the false prophets are. That's who walk around with these marks on right now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The beast, they gave it to them, and they represent the false prophet, represent them by having these marks. That's why they just got to doing this, what? Wednesday, right?
Yes, he did.
Mark in the forehead. I got one guy my daddy the mark of beast. I'm going to go away. Now, I'm like, dude, okay, you go over there, and you get that thing on your head, and mess around the pathway with that.
Woo!
That's your soul. Okay? So now, hold this spot right quick. I left something out. I want to go to 1 Corinthians 10. Because we're talking about feasting. We know feasts are on a what? Tape. You don't do feasts on the ground. You do feasts on tape. Now watch this. 1 Corinthians 10. And we're going right to verse 20.
Verse 20,
mm-hmm.
1 Corinthians 10 and 20.
Mm-hmm.
But I say that the things which Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice the devils and not to God.
Mm-hmm.
I would not have you should have fellowship with devils.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
You should not drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and the table of devils.
Wait a minute, that's on the Lord's table is the feast.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
What's on the table of the devil?
Okay,
all of that, which is to keep them, which is different from the Lord's table. The Lord's table got the feast that show you the shadow things to come. When you go look at what's on the devil's table, this stuff to keep you in the rest of the day. That's going to be judged. And when you go there,
pork.
Yeah, that's to get you slain when the Lord comes and is right.
Exactly.
And then you end up in that last resurrection. Are your business on the table?
That's too late.
That's why he said you're gonna look up, and when he here, you're gonna look up at the man that transgress to warn you what he gonna do with the people that transgress when they come up in their last resurrection. Which we're gonna read about right now. Let's go back to Revelations. Close it out. This feast is point to the shadow of things to come. Yep, 20 and verse 10. Oh, sorry, 10 and
2011.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away.
Mm-hmm.
And there was found no place for them.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were open.
Oh, the books are being opened now, huh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we opening the books now, y'all. How about you stand here and read? That's what we do. Not let me tell you anything that I did. I read out of this book. Okay?
Right.
Neither none of, because we open up the books now. Because really that eight days point to the day, look, that's why we try to get it right now. Hey, let me fix this and fix that. Oh my God, I know that we trying to figure it out. Because when this day comes, the judgment is set.
Mm-hmm.
Books is open and go ahead.
I saw the dead stand before God and the books were open, and another book were open, which is the book of life.
Mm-hmm.
And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works.
Mm-hmm.
And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and the death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them.
Mm-hmm.
And they were judged every man according to their works.
Yes, sir.
And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.
Yes, sir.
Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
That's why we rejoice for 7 days, y'all.
That's dead, man.
I know.
When that AJ get here, are you there? That fire? Okay? Yeah, it's a very sobering. Yeah, your shock group is just a little bit tighter on that AJ day. Because this is what it represents. That's what the feast point. So I hope you got some understanding of what the shadow of things to come,
man,
to the feast of the Lord.
Amen.